And that gets us to a question about why this universe and why a fine-tuned universe. In his book, Just Six Numbers, The Deep Forces That Shape the Universe, the leading astrophysicist, Martin Rees, argues that the universe is incredibly fine-tuned for life, and that we have three options when we think about this. The first is pure chance, which he finds extremely hard to believe. The second, it was planned that way by a creator, God, which he says many of his colleagues believe, but he does not. And third, there are infinite number of universes, and we happen to live in the one that actually sustains life. Sean, could you tell us, what do you think about this multiverse theory, and what does the fine-tuned universe really mean for us philosophically?
Yeah, I think two major things here. One is that I think that the confidence that we have in the statement that the universe in which we actually live really is finely tuned is very, very exaggerated in the popular imagination, and even among scientists. There's very little what I would call serious work done trying to quantify this. If you were really serious about the statement that the universe in which we live is finely tuned, especially for the existence of intelligent life, what does that mean? That means you would write down the space of all possible ways the universe could be. And then you would write down the space of all possible ways the universe could be in which there could be life. And then you would have some measure on both of those spaces, and you would do an integral of one and an integral of the other, and you would divide and get a fraction, and you would say it's a small number. Nobody does anything like that. What does it mean to have a universe that allows for the existence of life? It might mean that the universe has the computational capacity to be a Turing machine, that the universe can do any kind of calculation that you might want to conceivably do. And therefore, there can be parts of the universe that have intelligent information processing systems. If that's your definition, it's easy to get a universe that has the ability to contain intelligent life. Whereas in the actual discussions about fine-tuning, people are incredibly parochial and anthropocentric. They make statements like, well, you know, if we didn't have exactly the plate tectonics that we had on Earth 2 billion years ago, then life never would have made it past a certain stage. And that's an incredibly narrow view, that if life were any different than exactly the history that we actually had, it wouldn't have existed. The real way that we go from the fundamental laws of physics in our world to you and me and other intelligent beings is not something that we understand, even in the actual world. If you change the world to something else, to have the chutzpah to say, then life could not possibly exist, I find difficult to support. So I'm not sure that there is that much fine-tuning, to be honest. But maybe there is. I would consider it an open problem. To me, it's exactly analogous to a little over 100 years ago, we had Lord Kelvin worried about Darwinian evolution, because he was an expert in thermodynamics, and he calculated the lifetime of the sun, because the sun was burning coal or something like that, and there's not that many years the sun could have gone on burning. So there was a problem. The sun couldn't last long enough to actually support the entire necessary history of life to explain the evolution that we thought existed. And this was a big problem, but in retrospect, it was obvious we didn't understand the physics that well. To me, the fine-tuning problem is just like that. We don't understand the relevant physics that well. But of course, as you allude to, we also have a perfectly good naturalistic explanation, which can go under the innocent-sounding name of environmental selection. So no one is surprised that life arose on the surface of the Earth rather than on the surface of the sun, even though the surface of the sun is much bigger, or the volume of interstellar space where there's nothing there at all, much, much bigger than the volume of atmosphere here on Earth. And yet, we don't have this fine-tuning problem. How unlikely was it that we arose here on Earth? Why? Because the conditions here on Earth are obviously much different than on the sun or in interstellar space, and much more hospitable to the existence of life. So the multiverse idea simply says that the little tiny bit of universe that we can observe, a few tens of billion light years across, is not necessarily the whole universe. Maybe conditions are wildly different in other places in the universe. Just like Giordano Bruno made a big step hundreds of years ago when he said, maybe our planet, maybe our star is not the only one. Maybe there's millions of them. Well, maybe there are millions or more different universes. And many of them might not allow for the existence of life if it's true that life needs this kind of fine-tuning. Many people find this to be a little bit extravagant. You're just trying to explain the existence of life here in our universe, and you're postulating billions and billions and billions of other universes. But that attitude is completely misguided. Whether or not the multiverse is real, I have, you know, days in which I think it's likely and days in which I think it's don't, it's not extravagant. Because the multiverse is not a theory. It's not, there's this image that, you know, some physicists got tired of doing integrals and real work one day and collecting data, and they were sitting around with some beers and said, you know, like, dude, what if there were like a million universes? That would be awesome. That is not how it happened. What happens is you have theories like string theory to help explain quantum gravity and inflationary cosmology to explain the isotropy and homogeneity of the universe, theories that were invented for entirely different reasons, theories which are in themselves quite simple in their fundamental formulations, and these theories predict the existence of a multiverse. It's not like you separately postulate universe after universe. It's like the integers. There's an infinite number of integers, but no one thinks that's extravagant because there's a simple rule given one integer for making the next one. Likewise, with the multiverse, there's a simple set of rules that give you many, many, many universes. We don't know if those rules are true. It's very speculative physics, but it's not hard to get it or to imagine it. So if it turns out to be true, then you really need to finely tune the environmental conditions of the universe in order to get life, then we have a very easy way of doing that. It's not at all some knockdown, drag-out argument against naturalism.
To be fair, the rules that you're talking about are talking about some number of multiverses, but not infinite necessarily.
It doesn't really matter. Once you get more than one universe, getting the third and the fourth and the 10 to the 1,000th is no problem.
Very well. And Hans, do you think that this universe is fine-tuned? And how do you feel about the implications for a multiverse, whether it exists or whether there are many or many, many, many?
Okay, so I do believe this universe is fine-tuned, but I found that. So I sometimes teach, to earn a living, I teach introductory logic. And I've learned some interesting facts about human psychology doing this. One of those facts is humans have the hardest time detecting invalidity in arguments when they agree with the conclusion of the argument. Okay, so if you give a student an argument, a simple argument that is obviously invalid, but they're firmly committed to the conclusion, they may very well say it's valid. Okay. That's how I feel about the fine-tuning arguments, is I agree with the conclusion. I think God willed for there to be human beings. It could enter into a relationship with him. All the traditional things from a Christian worldview. But when I look at the arguments that people give for that, I go, no, I can't put my name behind that because, first of all, they have what look to me as false premises. As Sean mentioned, I agree completely with what Sean said. In fact, I'm very glad he said what he said because I was a little bit nervous that I was being too skeptical in my thoughts about this as sort of more of a student of the physics rather than someone who's doing cutting-edge work here. And I just thought, I know general relativity. I passed the exam. They never taught us how to compute the probability that the cosmological constant would lie in a certain range. That just wasn't part of the theory. And then when you get to the really hard parts, like, well, you know, put it into the Hamiltonian formulation and then take the Liouville measure on the space of universes, and you go, well, how do I calculate the size of the hospitable universes? It's a very hard problem. Thankfully, Sean and one of his graduate students did some of the calculations, and surprise, the life-friendly universes are actually pretty likely. So there's a lot of hard work to be done here that I'm afraid some of the advocates for fine-tuning arguments haven't done the work, and that's an embarrassment. So I think that should be stopped. I think people should work harder to understand the arguments they're making. But now, anytime you say an argument is not good, even if you agree with the conclusion, a lot of people also think that is a reason to sort of check off one of the reasons for believing in the conclusion, right? You go, aha, that argument didn't work, so therefore my credence in the conclusion goes down. I say that is okay reasoning, except if you already had a reason to be suspicious of those types of arguments. And I, pre-physics, already am worried about fine-tuning types of argument. So let me just mention one reason why I think if you just start thinking in terms of theological concepts, you'll think something really fishy is going on here. So let's think of the sort of picture that I'm sure it's been published elsewhere, but I saw Roger Penrose give a talk with this picture. And the picture was of this dartboard, this huge dartboard, and there's God sitting back there with the dart, and there's the bullseye. It's so small. And Penrose loves, you know, to write this huge number, right, of the possibilities. And God, we need God hit the bullseye. Because look, if you had a random mindless process, throw a dart at this target, it wouldn't go in the bullseye. And so then you think, aha, what do we need? We need God to put it there. Now here's where, if you're actually just thinking theologically, you go, no, God builds the target, right? God makes the laws of physics if God exists, if God's the creator. And so you don't need God. God doesn't need to pick out the right universe among all the ones he's constrained, you know, all these possibilities he has no control over. If he makes the laws, he decides which universes are possible. He decides how likely it is to have one of the two. So in other words, to put it in techie physics terms, God picks the measure on the space of possibilities. So would a theist want to say you need God to steer the universe out of its most likely outcome, namely lifeless? Doesn't sound theologically very sound to me.